Good morning.
Good morning.
Bert.
The hour is upon us. It is time for worship. This morning when we arrived, we were greeted by snow on the flowers. Right outside here. And as I posted on Facebook this morning, Pentecost Sunday.
Thank you.
us with the confident spirit of faith that our lives will show your love.
Come, Holy Spirit of God, be with us today in our thoughts and our prayers.
Come, Holy Spirit of God, be with us in our words and our deeds.
chapters 2, verses 1 through 8, 12 through 18, and 21. And we'll hear about the day of Pentecost, which is what I will hear. One of the reasons we hear. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from heaven there came a sound like the rush of violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues, as a fire, appeared among them, and the tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages, as the Spirit gave them ability. Now there were devout Jews living from every nation under heaven, living in Jerusalem. And at the sound of the crowd gathered, and was bewildered, because each one of them, speaking in the native language of each other, amazed and astonished, they asked, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear each of us?" All were amazed and perplexed, saying to one another, "What does this mean?" But the others sneered and said, "They are filled with new wine." But Peter, standing with the 11, raised his voice and addressed them, "Men of Judea and all who live in Jerusalem, let this be known to you and listen to what I say. Indeed, these are not drunk, as you suppose, for it is only 9 o'clock in the morning. No, this is what was spoken through the prophet Joel. In the last days it will be, God declares, that I will pour out my Spirit upon all flesh. And your sons and your daughters shall prophesy. And your young men shall see visions. And your old men shall dream dreams. Even upon slaves, both men and women, in those days I will pour out my Spirit, and they shall prophesy. Then everyone who calls on the name of the Lord shall be saved." This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Church worldwide, okay? And I'm going to tell you why. All right? It is called Pentecost Sunday. You all say Pentecost? Pentecost? Okay, all right. It's a time when we remember, it's the time when we remember that Jesus and the Father sent the Holy Spirit to live inside of us as Christians. Jesus promised that the Holy Spirit would come into the lives of those who followed him. And so many years ago, followers of Jesus gathered together on a special day called Pentecost. What's the day called? Pentecost, that's right. And then all of a sudden, the Holy Spirit of God came upon the people, and they received life and power to shine the light of Jesus in the world. Okay? Now they received life and what?
Power.
Say that again. Power. That's right. They received life and power to shine the light of Jesus in the world. That same Holy Spirit can give us power to live for Jesus. And so today I'm going to try to give you a little bit of an illustration. Do you all have a flashlight at home? Okay, all right. We're going to talk a little bit about the flashlight. Mm-hmm. Hold that for me. Now here is the on and off button right here. Can I click? Okay. Once you click it, tell me what happens. What? Nothing happens. Okay, maybe you get a better chance at it. Show where the on and off button is. Click it and let's see what happens. What happened with the light? What?
It didn't turn.
It did not turn on. So, now do you think? What do you think do we need to have it to turn on?
Batteries.
Oh. So you think maybe batteries might help it? Okay. I just happen to have some here. All right, so I'm going to take a look again. Take that. Trying to put inside of our lives different things. give us power to live for God and to shine the light of Christ. So that's why we need the Holy Spirit to help us to live for God and shine the light of who? What's the same answer?
Jesus.
There you go.
All right, very good. All right, well, that's our message for you all today. So come on, let's get in a circle so we can have our closing prayer. All right, hold hands there. And repeat after me. Dear God, thank you that you have sent us the power of the Holy Spirit. Please fill us up each day with the Holy Spirit that we would have the power to live for Jesus and let His light shine in our lives. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right, here we go. Just to announce, as I forget, I'll do this now, the choir should eat first so that after that you all can go and practice. I think that the Simpson youth should be coming to help clean up so you all don't have to worry about all of that. So, choir eat first and then you can go and practice. All right. Let us pray. Loving God, we thank you so much for allowing us to gather this day on Pentecost Sunday. We thank you, God. And we pray that you will be with us as you speak to us through your word. Letting Darnay sit down and you standing up and sharing with us what it is that you have for us this day. Binding the enemy so he won't steal your word from our hearts, as well as letting the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart being acceptable in your sight. O Lord, you who are our strength and our redeemer. In Jesus' name I pray and ask all these things. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. You've heard the reading of our scripture from Acts, the second chapter, verses 1 through 8, and then 12 to 18, and verse 21. And because I just really like this title today, I'm going to invite you all to say this. You don't have to say it if you don't like it, and if you don't want to. But the title of the message is, if you ever meet, neighbor.
Neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
Oh, neighbor.
The title of the message is,
my message is,
fire in the hole.
Fire in the hole.
I really like that. Fire in the hole. Of course, today is Pentecost Sunday, and it's the birthday of the church, and so we thank God for this celebration. As I was telling the young people, it is, of course, the anniversary of Christ, not of this church, but the birthday of the church worldwide. And it is a day that was celebrated for years, and it actually means 50. Or 50 days after the Passover, or as we who are in Christian faith say, 50 days after Easter. And that is when the Holy Spirit pretty much made his presence in the way that he did. Now, really the Spirit of the Lord had been here from the beginning. Alpha, Omega, Trinity, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. If you read through some passages in the Old Testament, you will find out that the Holy Spirit is called the Spirit of the Lord. Pretty much the same thing. It's just that in the Old Testament, it was manifested one way, and in the New Testament, it is definitely manifested in another. And we find that from our scripture today, how the disciples were kind of all in one place, and they were in the upper room, and what they don't know is whether or not there were 11 disciples or if it was like 120 disciples, okay? Which you can find that in the first chapter of the book of Acts. And either way, I think the commentaries believe that it was a lot more of like 120 of them gathered together. And so when the Holy Spirit came, it came in with like the sound of the rushing wind. And then, of course, as it lit on the disciples, it was like tongues of fire. And so that's why we get the whole association with red, the color of red, and the flames when you see it depicted, because it is representative of fire and flames. And so when it happened, and they were all just, you know, talking in other tongues, and people were wondering, what in the world is going on? Well, here's the thing. We can do a study on tongues at a later time. There are different varieties of tongues. In particular, this variety of tongues were tongues that were actual foreign languages that were being spoken by the disciples. Because there were people there at this particular festival from other countries or other parts of the area who spoke a different language or had a different dialect. And they were able to hear their language being spoken. So they were like, what in the world is going on. Now, there are other different tongues. There are tongues that are all prayer languages, as you may, you know, have heard from other churches. And then there are tongues that are spoken that are really also heavenly tongues, but there are also tongues that they have to have what's called an interpretation to go along with it, okay? So, like I said, we can do another study on that later. And then there was so much, I guess, noise or whatever it is you want to call it, that people thought that they were drunk. You know, they were saying, oh my God, what's going on up there? They must be drinking. And of course, Peter said, no, that's not it. They're not drunk. They're not drunk, I assure you. And then he read, of course, a prophecy from the Old Testament. And so here today, this theophany, or the way that spiritual things can occur here on our planet, happened with the disciples. Now, the text does not indicate either actual wind or actual fire, but only a sound like wind and divided tongues as of fire. So there are different interpretations to that particular scripture as well. But the point is, this is when the Holy Spirit came and manifested itself in that particular presence. And so, we are not surprised, although the disciples may have been and others may have been, about this sudden appearance of the Holy Spirit, because Jesus had told his disciples that the Holy Spirit is going to come. He had told them previously. In John 14th chapter, verses 25 and 26, before he left, he said, "All this I have spoken to you while I am still with you. But the Comforter, which is the Holy Ghost, or the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said unto you." And so Jesus was already letting them know that the Holy Spirit was coming. Now, as I was praying about what to preach for today, that is the title that came into my head, Fire in the Hole. And I said, "Lord, okay, I hope that's you, but I don't understand where you're going with this." And so I said, "Well, I will do my research." And you know what? This is what I found out. And I thank God is awesome. Because what Jesus was really saying when he told them that the Holy Ghost was coming, that the Holy Spirit was coming to the earth, he was saying, "Fire in the hole!" That's what he was really saying. Fire in the hole. And why? I know, why do you think I'm saying this? I'm saying this because of the definition of fire in the hole. And so it says that a fire in the hole, and some of you may be more aware of this than others, especially if you were in the military or things like that, but it is a warning that an explosive detonation in a confined space is imminent. It, of course, originated with the miners and coal mines who needed to warn their fellows that a charge had been set. And of course, after the charge had been set, you know that after that, hearing fire in the hole, that some type of explosion was going to happen. It says that the term has been used once again in the state mining regulations and the military and corporate procedures, and also even in NASA has used the fire in the hole. And then also the term fire in the hole, which, you know, we have a variety of people here. You may have seen it in some type of art, some type of media, some type of television show, and even some type of music. I think there's a song by ABBA that talks about fire in the hole. But nowadays, it's just common to use it as a catchphrase, the words fire in the hole, which means pretty much watch out, stand back, or something exciting and important is about to happen. And it also has become an all-purpose synonym for the words, you know, heads up, look out, watch out, something is coming, something exciting is coming. And that, my friends, is what Jesus was saying to us and to his disciples, that hold up, watch out, heads up, fire in the hole, because something, someone exciting is coming, and important. And that someone, that one that is important, is none other than God the Father, God the the Son, but God the Holy Spirit. Once again, Jesus tells us that the Comforter is coming, which again is the Holy Ghost. And he says, the Father will send in my name. He shall teach you all things and bring all things to your remembrance whatsoever I have said to you. The Holy Spirit, the Comforter, the Dunamis, the powerful one is coming. So fire in the hole. Watch out. And you have to understand how powerful this is. Because if you go back and you look up the Greek word dunamis is used 120 times in the New Testament, okay? And loosely, the word refers to strength, to power, or to ability, okay? Strength, power, and ability. And dunamis is the root word of our English words where we get dynamite, dynamo, and dynamic. So here again, as we look in the book of Acts, this time in the first chapter, verse 8, it says this, but you will receive dunamis. That's the Greek word, and that stands for power. But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. The disciples could not do anything on their own if they wanted to, but they were empowered by the Holy Spirit to carry out all the things that they did, into which has been a blessing, because some 2,000 years later, we are here in this church, and churches around the world are worshiping God because the power of the Holy Spirit was put on the disciples, and it gave them that strength and that ability and that power that they needed to go and to tell others about Jesus Christ. And that is the same power that we have available to us today, not only for strength and help and ability to go out to witness and to tell others about Jesus Christ, but just to be able to live day to day in this world. You wonder why so many people fall by the wayside. So many people don't make it in life because they don't have our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ living in them to give them the power that they need to make it just another day. We look on TV, we listen to the radio and all of the above, and we see people who are just doing all kind of crazy stuff. And most of the time, it's because they don't have the Lord in their life. They're doing what comes natural to someone who's in the flesh. And the thing that keeps us from doing some of the crazy stuff, even though sometimes we think it, we do, is because we've got that power living inside of us. That Holy Spirit that kind of whispers in our heads and in our minds and our hearts and says, hold on, stop me before you do that. Before you go and cuss that person out. Before you want to, because you know you want to. Some of us sometimes just go and slap somebody upside the head. And then you hear this voice inside of you saying, no, don't do that. That too, my friends, is the Holy Spirit. But today, we have the power to do whatever it is that God has called us to do. As individuals, as well as the church. Today, you have the power to do what God has called you to do. Because of the power of the Holy Spirit, you can achieve the goals of life that you have. You can get through those crisis situations that you're going through or maybe going through in the future. And you also, because of the power of the Holy Spirit, you have been given the ability to love those who are unlovable. I know you all don't know anybody like that, because everyone's having great times in their jobs. All your neighbors are cool. And all your family members are just doing the right things. Amen? Hallelujah. Glory, yes. Not really. It's that Holy Ghost power inside of us that helps us to change the things in our lives and in the world, just like it did the disciples over 2,000 years ago. The Holy Spirit is the one who allows us to put one foot in front of the other when you get up in the morning. The Holy Spirit is the one who, for some reason or another, will allow somebody to call someone will walk by you and give you a smile or a hug, they can have. Just when you need one. The Holy Spirit is real. The Holy Spirit is powerful. Now here's the thing. The Holy Spirit, there's so much more to the Holy Spirit. But it depends on how much you want. If you were just satisfied with the Holy Spirit working in your life the way He is now, then that's cool. That's between you and God. But there's so much more that the Holy Spirit has for us and through us. And even John Wesley, even though he had already given his life to the Lord, even though he had already started Bible clubs, he would have that Aldersgate experience, and where he said, "I felt my heart strangely warmed." And so the Holy Spirit can also warm your hearts, especially when they get cold. But as I close, let me say this. Today is a great day. As we remember the Holy Spirit, as we remember His coming to earth, and doing for us those things that we cannot do on our own, to help us to not only tell us about Jesus, but help us to get through with power and strength the abilities that we need to. Don't give up. Don't give up on life. I know some of you are aging, and some of you are saying, "This is it. This is the end. This is near." But you know what? I saw a lady who was 100 years old running track. And she started when she was in her 60s. So don't give up. Don't stop working for the Lord. Don't stop working for your families. Don't just throw in the towel and say, "Oh, the end is near." Get busy. Get the Holy Spirit. Get energized. Get some power, some strength, and all that goes along with that. To continue on, to look up to the Lord, and to be able to do those things that God will allow for you to do. But because you're settled in, thinking, "I'm just too old, I can't do it, you know, I got a bad leg and a bad hip, and all goes along with that, and I'm starting to experience some of those things myself, so I'm not making fun." But don't give up, because God is there for you, Jesus is there for you, and with the power of the Holy Spirit behind you, you still can do what God has called you to do. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Let us pray. Loving Lord, we thank you so much for your word today, reminding us about the power of the Holy Spirit, that we don't have to be sad and depressed and all that goes along with that, because you've given us strength, you've given us power, you've given us the ability, oh God, to do whatever it is that we can do, even in our present state. But we will not sit and wallow in pity and in sorrow and depression, thinking that it's all over, because your word reminds us today that it is not. That we are called upon the Holy Spirit for that strength that we need, for that power, that dunamis power, that dynamite power that you said fire in the hole is coming. Thank you for this reminder, and help us to govern ourselves accordingly. And then, of course, if there's anyone here under the sound of my voice, and you've never given Jesus your life, and you're missing out on the power of the Holy Spirit, and all you have to do is say this prayer. You don't have to say it out loud, but you can say it to yourself something like this. "Dear Jesus, please forgive me for all of my sins. I believe that you died on the cross, and that you rose again, and that you're coming back again. So now I confess that I've given you my life. Take my life, leave my life, and when it comes time for me to die, for I surely will die one day, but right, not right now, and or be caught in the rapture, take me home to heaven to live with you. For in Jesus' name, and I do pray and ask all these things. Amen." Amen. And of course, if you said that prayer, the angels in heaven are rejoicing, and I rejoice with you. Please go to our bulletin for Christian discipleship information as well as membership. Please feel free to call the office. And I'm not done with this message, because there's so much that God has given me. And so next week, Lord willing, we're going to talk about the Holy Spirit and how He is a comforter and how it is that He can help us with these holes that we have in our hearts. And yes, sometimes those holes that we have in our souls. So I hope you come back and bring somebody else with you to hear what God has for us coming up next week. Amen. We're going to move forward now as we have our pastoral prayer. All right, thank you. And once again, okay, I've already announced about the choir meeting first, so you can come back up to practice. Prayers for Tony Pangalo, who has a health issue, and for a friend, Cherise, who lost her mother on Friday. Also for Sherry Basenbach's mom, Mrs. Stewart? Sherry Basenbach's mom. I can't even pronounce her name, sorry about that. Also praying for Tom to continue doing well. Thank you everyone, God bless. Please pray for Jim to continue doing well. Thank you everyone, God bless. Also praying for, once again, it says my friends, Mother passed away. Give, I think it's Sam and Sharice your comfort and peace. That's from Jan Pombalo. Marie, he is letting us know that some of her things have been thrown away. And she never got a chance to use some of it, and she needs our help. So you can see Marie afterwards. And we are all also praying that the weather gets warmer too, Marie. Thank you. And praying for Russ Van Sayak, who's going to be having some gallbladder surgery this week. All right. So let's make sure that we keep everyone in our prayers. We're going to begin now with silent prayer to give you an opportunity to bring your personal joys and concerns to the Lord. Then we'll come in with the pastoral prayer, and then we'll conclude together with the Lord's Prayer. So with that, let us begin our time. Our Heavenly Father, we do come before you on this Pentecost Sunday, thanking you so much for just the ability to be here in your house, oh God, with so many things happening over the highways and byways and in our neighborhoods and in our communities, oh God. We thank you that you allowed us to step foot into your house one more time, and we give you all the glory and the honor and praise for that. And now, Lord, not only do we worship you today, but we also come to ask for forgiveness for all of our sins, to thank you for all of the joys in our lives, as well as to present to you all of our concerns. God, we like to sometimes settle into nice, comfortable routines, those in which we don't have to do much of anything, but just to sit back and relax. Some of us are tired, and we wonder if we have anything left to give above our talents, our spirits, or our lives. So the story of the disciples hiding in the upper room is not really uncomfortable for many of us, because some of us want to hide too. But you have come to us in your resurrection love. We have seen the prints of the nails in your hands and feet. We have felt the wound in your side. We have been with you on the seashore, but we still quiver sometimes with fear and uncertainty. So send your Holy Spirit upon us today. Let the rushing wind of your Spirit stir us up to action for good and for healing. Let the flame of your power ignite our hearts with passion for justice and peace. And as we have, of course, brought names of people to prayer this day, asking for comfort and even asking for healing mercies, may we also add our names, asking for empowerment, strength, and ability, and renewal of our spirits. Take us and use our gifts and our talents for healing in your world. Help us to be bold in our proclamation of your great good news of love and hope. And then as we take time to close out our prayer, we do want to remember all our military, firefighters, police officers, and all of us as citizens of God, to protect us all as much as possible. And Lord, we also want to thank you so much for growth and pray for more spiritually, numerically, and financially, oh God. so that we can carry out the mission and the vision in which you have given us in this place. Help us, oh God, in knowing our situations are in terms of all that we need. But Lord, if you don't send it, we can't get it done. But send it, oh God, to send people, send finances, and send your spirit especially, just to move in the hearts of your people so they will come up and understand what is it that I can do to serve the Lord here in this place. Bless us now. Thank you, Jesus, for your word. Thank you, Lord, for your people who brave the cold and the rain and the snow in May to come out to your house today. So bless us all now. Bless our concert this afternoon. Bless our meal, oh God, that we're about to receive. And we just thank you, Jesus, for your wonderful grace and mercy towards us all. For we ask all these things in the precious and powerful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. Let every heart say amen. Amen. And then, oh God, you've given us this wonderful, awesome, powerful prayer to pray, as in our Father.
Lord in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Spirit song from our Methodist.